Hi everybody, Mr. Ong here. This is the third and final video showing the impact of Stalin. In this video, we'll be looking at his social impact, asking ourselves a question: what were the impacts of Stalin's policies on the Soviet citizens? And the other question we want to think about is, did everyone have the same experience of Stalin's rule? Did everybody share in the same benefits? Did everybody share in the same suffering? What we'll see is that there's going to be differences in how people experience Stalin's impact. This is an overview of this section of the chapter. There are going to be three parts. The first part talks about the state control of society that comes about in a communist and socialist country. Unfortunately, we'll discover is that Stalin's impact is going to result in a fall of the standards of living for the citizens, the famine on the citizens. We have talked about it in the previous two videos. And the last one is a lack of consumer goods, lack of goods that the average ordinary citizen would be using. The second thing we'll talk about is the living in fear, the characterized by terror. We have seen bits of this in the previous video on the Great Terror and the Purges. And finally, we want to be looking at the various social groups in the Soviet Union. For example, people from minority nationalities, the other ethnic groups in Soviet society. We look at the women, look at the children and the youth under education, and look at how the Soviet society was being recreated as a new Soviet man. Let's start off by talking about the state control of society. So in a socialist or in a communist country, all private ownership is banned. You cannot own your own business, you cannot own your own shops. Instead, the state is the one that owns and distributes all social goods. They will tell you exactly how who's going to stay in which house. They're going to determine the kind of education, the kind of healthcare you're going to get. Okay, so the state is the one that points and tells you what to do. Unfortunately, in this inefficient society, the Soviet society is going to be marked out and is going to be distinguished by long queues, because people are going to be queuing for hours on end for very little goods that will be supplied by the state. Okay. So the first effect is the fall in the standard of living experienced by the general Soviet society. This is because there's going to be a shortage of consumer goods, things like your clothes and bicycles. This was made worsened by the famine in the 1930s, where even things like your bread had to be rationed. And the other reason for why there was a shortage of consumer goods was simply because it wasn't the focus of Stalin to prioritize benefiting the individual citizens. Instead, his focus was to help agriculture, help industries to develop, and to prepare for war eventually. So it was a common sight to go to grocery stores to see that the shelves are going to be empty. The second effect was the famine. Millions of people had died from starvation. We talked about this in the previous two videos. The next point was that citizens in the Soviet Union lived in fear because of the secret police, the NKVD informers. They were everywhere, and people could be arrested on the slightest suspicion of being disloyal to Stalin. Okay, the NKVD informers could be people like your neighbors, could be your boss, could be your milk delivery person. Right, you have no idea who they are, but you suspect that everybody could be working for Stalin. And people knew that they were constantly being watched and judged, and that during the time of the Great Terror, the consequence of being arrested on suspicions of disloyalty was executions or being sent to the gulags. Okay. Now, let's take a look at how Stalin's policies affected various social groups, starting with the minority nationalities in the Soviet Union. We recall that the USSR stands for the Union of Soviet Socialist Republics. This means that the USSR consists of many different types of countries with many different ethnic groups. There was your majority Russians, there were your Ukrainians, your Georgians, your Turkish people, and so on and so forth. There were many, many different ethnic groups. However, despite the name being a union, it suggests that it's equal people, equal basis. It wasn't a fair union. However, those who were considered ethnic minorities, those who were not ethnically Russian, gradually lost their autonomy with the USSR. Autonomy means the ability to decide how you want to rule your own ethnic group, how you want to live your own life. The central government in Russia was central Soviet government in Moscow was predominantly a Russian government. They were the ones who determined how all of the different ethnic groups across the whole Soviet Union were to live. And because Stalin believed that modernization and industrialization were more important than preserving these different cultural traditions, it would be tragic because his policies will result in the sufferings of millions of people, especially people from the minority ethnic groups. There were strong suspicions that the famine that took place in the 1930s in Ukraine was a man-made famine. Okay? It was Stalin's attempt to eliminate opposition from the Ukrainian minority nationality. Okay? So for minority nationality groups, they experienced a very negative impact under Stalin's rule. Okay. Now, what about the average Soviet citizen? Okay, we recall in the previous video, we talked about how Stalin used propaganda to shape truth, to shape what people believed. Okay, one of the ways he also tried to shape people was to create a model citizen, create a new Soviet man that everybody was supposed to try to become. That it was the goal and vision for the Soviet society. So this Soviet man is an ideal Soviet citizen who was proud to serve the Soviet Union selflessly and enthusiastically. The key example for this are your Stakhanovites, named after Alexei Stakhanov. So Stakhanov was the guy who supposedly mined a record 102 tons of coal in a single shift. This is 14 times his quota. Stalin would praise him as a hero of the revolution and cite him as an example of a shop worker and a new Soviet man that is supposed to inspire others to meet those similarly high targets for production. The reality, of course, is that it's very hard to meet these targets, and the consequence of not meeting these targets would be severe punishment. After a while, Soviet citizens grew cynical, they grew pessimistic, they started to wonder if this Stakhanovite movement was just a propaganda campaign. And eventually, many of them became fed up with the five-year plans. The third social group we want to look at are the women. In this case, it seems quite positive because women were finally allowed to enter the workforce, and the Soviet constitution refers to the laws of the Soviet Union, it guaranteed equal rights to women. So an example, according to the textbook, of how women gained equal rights is that abortion and divorce were legalized. The idea being you can give women more control over their own lives, over their own bodies. At the same time, women were encouraged to enter the workforce, contribute to the Soviet economy. This is in stark contrast to what was happening in Germany, where your German women were told to stay at home, to be a housewife, to focus on making babies for the state. So over here, it seems that the Soviet Union is quite progressive, quite positive impact on women. Okay, last big group that we want to look at are the youth under education. Okay. Education was a big priority in the USSR, and the USSR was actually known for worldwide for being very successful in raising literacy rates. Literacy rates refer to the number of people who can actually read and write. This was because each child was entitled to at least 9 years of free and compulsory education. Now, a question you should be asking yourself is, why would the Soviet Union prioritize education this much? Okay, two reasons. The first reason is because education was loaded with propaganda that emphasized communism and atheism. Okay, atheism is because it's the idea that there are no gods and there's no religion except for the religion that Stalin imposes on everybody. So Stalin was trying to eliminate religions like Christianity, like Islam, and replace it with a worship of himself. And so one of the priorities for education was to shape people's minds using propaganda. The other focus of the education system was on technical subjects that will help produce workers for industrialization. Aside from just your academics, there were your communist youth groups. So teenagers were encouraged to join Komsomol, that's your communist youth group. And in these groups, they will do outdoor activities and they'll be taught to be loyal to Stalin and the Communist Party. This is going to be very similar to what you will see in Hitler Youth under the Hitler chapter. And these children and young people were sent out across the USSR to work on political campaigns in collective farms and industries. Okay, the broad idea here is Stalin wanted to win over the loyalty of the young people. And if he could start by brainwashing the young, they will eventually grow up into his supporters. Okay, so that sums up the section on Stalin's social impact. Okay, remember, the point of these chapters isn't just to memorize content, but to categorize it according to positive and to negative impacts on Soviet society. Okay, so over here, the left-hand side, generally, okay, not generally, these are all pretty negative impacts on Soviet society, along with living in fear. Under impact of policies on various social groups, now here, you have more examples that you can use to show how there could be positive impacts on society. For instance, women's entry into the workforce, that sounds like a pretty good thing. Compulsory schooling and increased literacy rates, that sounds like a pretty good thing as well. loss of autonomy by minority nationalities, that seems pretty negative, and the creation of a new Soviet man seems pretty negative as well. Okay, so just be able to categorize this accordingly under social impact. Okay, that's all for today's lesson.